Harold Burr, who was this guy, was working in the 30s, 1930s, 40s, and 50s. Okay. He had one of the first good voltmeters around, and he went around measuring things, you know, elm trees and rabbits and tumors and embryos and all kinds of stuff. On the basis of this, he wrote an amazing book that basically said most of the things that we're discovering now. The guy had a crystal ball. It's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. So he could clearly see a lot of this stuff. The thing, the one thing he did not see, because at the time it didn't exist, was the computational aspects and the really the link to, you know, to this as a kind of neuroscience done in another space and morphous space. That I think is new, but people had already had these ideas, and it needed the technology to really make it, to really prove them out and to really see how it works.
I'll be showing people some overlays of some of the cells with the blue and green and red voltage colors. Now, voltage is actually fairly abstract for most people, but what's not abstract is something like an electron. People can fathom that, that has a certain charge. So when someone is looking at these videos of voltage gradients and they're colored, what is one seeing? Essentially, I'm asking you to explain what voltage is simply, but in terms of electrons, in terms of something that people can understand.
Yeah.
In order to understand voltage, you have to understand potential, and you also have to understand fields technically if you want to understand that correctly.
Yeah, it's not so bad. You don't need to really do much with fields in this one at all, because all of the things that I'm talking about are really not fundamentally fields per se. They're just spatial distributions of voltage gradients. And to understand a voltage gradient, it's pretty simple. Instead of electrons, life uses electrons too, but mostly the kinds of stuff that we're talking about uses a different charged particle. They use potassium, chloride, sodium, and protons. Okay, but otherwise, same deal. And so any cell has a cell membrane around it, the outer surface, and it has these ion channels, which are these little portals, these little proteins that can open and close and let specific ions like potassium or sodium in and out. These potassium, you know, so potassium and sodium are both positively charged. So you can imagine that if you're a cell and you let a bunch of your positively charged potassiums out, you can have an imbalance, more positives out here, less positives inside. So now there's going to be a voltage gradient, basically a battery in effect. I mean, that's basically what a battery is, right? It's a membrane with a charge disbalance on across it. That's all this is. So every cell is a battery. It achieves that by using energy to pump ions in a particular direction. And as a result, if you were to take a tiny little voltmeter and put it across, and people, that's exactly what electrophysiologists do, you put it across that cell membrane, you're going to read a voltage of some sort. You know, it's usually somewhere between, I don't know, between 20 millivolts and 70 millivolts, something like that, right? That's all it is. And so now you imagine doing that for every cell in the tissue that you're looking at, and you're just going to color every cell depending on how big that voltage difference is. You're going to color it red if the voltage difference is quite small. That's called being depolarized, meaning there's just not that much imbalance. It's pretty much, it's quite similar, you know, the ions inside and outside are pretty similar. So you're going to color those red. And then the ones that are really different, where there's a ton of positive charges that have been kicked out, so the cell is really pretty negative, that compared to the outside space, that you're going to color those, blue. And that's what you're looking at.
Great. Okay, so now we have some background as to what, so DNA codes for proteins, and you can think of that as low level, and then what you're discovering, and you and your teams, and the teams that you collaborate with, are discovering is that there's these non-neurobioelectric signals, and those are somewhat like large-scale code. Some of the implications are regeneration of limbs, barely touched on, that's okay. We touched on generation of eyes, not regeneration of eyes. And then you were about to get into cancer, so do you mind?
Yeah. So real quick to say, the analogy is, I think a good analogy is this. The DNA is what encodes the hardware. Okay. And the electrical dynamics are the software. Now, a lot of people get upset at this because they say, living things are not like a computer. So I am certainly not claiming that living things are like the kind of computers that you and I use on a daily basis. This architecture is not what life is using. However, the deeper concept from computer science, which is the idea of reprogrammable hardware and the idea of software, multi-layer software, where you could be programming in machine code, or you could be looking for higher level subroutines and higher level languages, that I think is quite realistic. And I think what we're looking for here is to understand, basically, to find the best the best representation of that software so that we can manipulate it as to advantage, basically, and to understand how evolution manipulates it. And so the other, you know, you had asked for three examples. So there are three basic examples I wanted to give. So the electric face was one. There's a cancer example, and then there's a planarian flatworm regeneration example. So the cancer example would look like this. One of the things about cancer, the one way to think about cancer is to ask the question, why is there ever anything but cancer? In other words, individual cells like amoebas are extremely competent on their own. They handle single cell level goals quite well. Why do they ever get together to form something like a kidney or a liver? Because when there's a cancer, what you're seeing is a defection from that process. You're seeing cells that normally should be working on making a nice organ upkeeping a nice organ in an adult. Instead of that, they go off and they basically revert to a single cell kind of existence. They basically become like an amoeba. They treat the rest of the body as just environment. It's like external environment. So you can think of that computational boundary between self and world can shrink. It can grow when a bunch of amoeba-like cells get together and they build something like an organ or a whole body, that computational boundary grows. But it can also shrink because an individual cell can say, I'm not working on this anymore. I'm just an amoeba and I'm going to do what amoebas do. What do? They become two amoebas and two amoebas become four and so on. They overproliferate and they go where life is good. So they metastasize to wherever they want to go. So that's cancer. So if you think about it that way, that cancer is this like defection from multicellular cooperation. You ask yourself, okay, so what is the process that normally keeps them harnessed towards specific goals? And so if you ask yourself, what do we know that's a process that harnesses individual competent subunits towards larger scale goals? That's very clear. That's the neural-like processing, because you have individual neurons, which are cells, but you connect them together into a network, and this amazing computation starts to take place that can do things like plan for the future and have memories and have preferences and goals on a large scale. You know, you as an organism can have goals and memories that your individual cells don't have. So we know that electrical networks are really good at binding small competent subunits into larger scale computational agents. We take advantage of that in computer science. Evolution takes advantage of it in making neurons. So we asked the following question. Okay, could that be the basis of cancer? And now I must say that we're not the first to have this idea. Okay, again, Harold Burr said this in the 30s. But so we did three things. We said, okay, first of all, when this process happens, can you see, using the voltage dyes, can you see the cells defecting from the electrical network? And in fact, you can. So what you can do is before it happens. So you can inject a human oncogene, which is going to form a tumor in a tadpole. You inject that into a tadpole. It makes a tumor. And even before that tumor becomes apparent, you can see with a voltage dye, you can see that those cells become highly depolarized. They electrically uncouple from the rest of the tissue and they go on their way. And they just treat, to them, the rest of the animal is just external environment at that point. So they become electrically uncoupled. And that's the first thing that oncogenes do, is electrically isolate the cell from its neighbors, from that collection of signals that normally tell the cell what to do in a larger context. So that's the first thing we did. The second thing we did, we said, well, If that's a potential cause of cancer, could we cause cancer just by disrupting the electrical communication directly? No oncogenes, no carcinogens, no DNA damage, no mutations, nothing wrong with the cells that any molecular biology test could see. And could we cause cancer? Because remember, the standard model in the field for years has been that cancer is the cause of genetic damage, basically, right? That it's a genetic disruption that makes a rogue cell that has other mutations and so on. So we said, fine, no, we're going to take completely normal cells, nothing wrong with them, and we're going to simply prevent them from talking to other cells electrically. Okay, we're just going to manipulate that. And so we did that, and sure enough, we made metastatic melanoma in tadpoles. So that tells you that there doesn't have to be anything wrong with the hardware in order to have cancer. It can be a purely physiological phenomenon. It can be caused at the software level, which a lot of people who study stress-induced cancers and things like this, they kind of already knew. But really, the paradigm has been that there has to be a genetic defect at the root of this somewhere. Okay. And then the third thing we found, which is, of course, the most exciting thing, which is you can go in the opposite direction. You can inject a really powerful human oncogene, like a P53 mutation.
Oncogene, for those who are listening, is just a gene that causes cancer.
Yeah, an oncogene is a mutation in the normal gene that is thought to cause a cancer transformation to cancer. Yeah.
Okay.
So you can inject that, and then if you do that into a tadpole, if you at the same time inject an ion channel that forces the cell to remain in an electrical state where it's connected to its neighbors and it doesn't depolarize, then even though that oncogene is blazingly strongly expressed, you won't have a tumor, because you're overriding that. There's a hardware problem, but it doesn't matter because you're overriding it and saying, yeah, I know you want to depolarize, but you can't. You have to stay connected to these neighbors, and you're just going to be part of this. And we can override that way a variety of different types of oncogenes.
Okay, so I was just having an analogy in my head. It's almost like, imagine you have these kids and they're misbehaved. So you can say, well, it's the kids who are the problem and they cause havoc in the house. But if you have an adult who's stern enough, they can override the misbehaved kids. If you leave the kids without the adult, then the house will be in shambles. In this analogy, the adult is like the electrical communication. So you can force that electrical communication, that standard adaptive electrical communication.
Yeah, yeah, you can think of it that way. I mean, the thing where I think it breaks down a little bit is that we're not introducing an extra element that keeps everybody else in line, right? We're in effect, it's like you have a bunch of kids that know what to do, and you've got one that's wearing dark glasses and he can't see, and he's causing all kinds of trouble because he can't see what he's doing. Well, you can put a camera on him or take the glasses off or something, so that he just goes right back into the interactions with the rest of the group. It's about communication. It's about binding the individual competent subunits towards a larger goal. Your goal is not simply to grow as much as you can, the way an amoeba is. Your goal is to build a hand or a liver or an eye or something else. It's really about the scale-up of goals, and electrical networks are great for this.
Does your work have any implications for what it means to have an identity? So right now you were talking about cancer as if it's dissociating from the larger self.
Yeah,
Then there are gap junctions, which you've referenced in your other work, and they effectively make an equivalence class between signals that I generate as a cell or my environment, or signals from connected cells. I'm unable to tell the difference between them.
Yep.
Because I'm unable to tell the difference between myself and my neighbor, it's as if I'm identified with them. So it has plenty of bearing, at least I see it has plenty of bearing as for what it means for the I or the ego in a non-pejorative manner. So what are the implications of your work for the concept of identity?
No, you've put your finger exactly on it. So 2 years ago, I wrote this paper called "On the Boundary of the Self," and it's exactly this idea. It's the way to define what is a self at different scales, and how does the boundary, the size of that self, change over time? And that's exactly the kind of thing that you're talking about. It's having communication channels that partially wipe the metadata on information so that I no longer know whether it came from you or whether it came from me, right? Gives us a partial mind melt, because now it's really hard to keep an identity. If I can't tell which are my memories and which are your memories, it's really hard for us to keep distinct identities. We become partially unified. And that's exactly the sort of process that evolution exploits to build larger selves out of small, competent ones.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.